Hello, welcome to Free Bible Commentary with Pastor Teacher Dr. Bob Utley. Be sure to visit Free Bible Commentary at www.freebiblecommentary.org. Now, here's Bob.
Isaiah chapter 60 through 62 today, which really forms a small literary unit inside the much larger literary unit of chapters 40 through 66. There is a radical break between 59 and 60. It's almost like light and dark, the discouragement of 59 and the hope of 60. The general theme that keeps 60, 61, and 62 in a literary unit is the future hope of the people of God as exemplified in the restoration of Jerusalem. And, of course, that's the setting of these three chapters. I'd like you to notice in chapter 60, in verse 1, the number of times the metaphors of light are used. Arise speaks of the sun coming up. Shine, light, glory. The Lord has risen, sun coming up. Rise, glory will appear, brightness, and then radiant down in verse 5. These metaphors for light are metaphors that are used throughout this section. I have a graphic I'd like to show you that talks about these metaphors, for I think they symbolize several things. Number one, the presence of God in chapter 60, 1 and 2, and then verses 19 and 20, and they almost exactly match the concept in Revelation 21, 23 and 22, 5. Now, spiritual wholeness, or the Christ-likeness of God's people that we would say today, is in chapter 60, 1 through 5, 21 and 62, 1. Now, those other places that you see on your screen are where metaphors of light are used in Isaiah, 9, 2, 58, 8, 59, 5, and 62, 1. Now, because of this recurrent theme, it is obvious that light is a symbol of God. The Shekinah cloud of glory, the pillar of fire, was a symbol of God. Whenever God appears, light, radiance, brilliance, one of the words for the second coming, epiphany, means a brilliance, a radiance, and that's what we have here. Now, we must remember the subject of chapter 61 is really not spelled out till verse 14. But in verse 14, it's obvious that the city of Jerusalem is what's being spoken of, which symbolizes the entire people of God. Now, notice where it says, arise, shine in verse 1, and lift up and see in verse 4. These are four imperatives. It is a command that the people get ready for God's coming. As you know, in Ezekiel, God's Spirit left the temple and moved east with the exiles. Now God's Spirit is returning, and that's the symbolism here. And verse 3 where it says, the nations will come to your light. I'm going to be talking about this more in chapter 61, because in 61, 6, 9, 11, and in 62 to some extent, it talks about Israel fulfilling her function as the kingdom of priests, Exodus 19, 5 and 6. And we'll be getting that next chapter. Now, notice where it mentions, your sons will come from afar, verse 4. Throughout this chapter is a play on the return of the people of God and the return of the Gentiles to God. As Israel was meant to be a light to all the peoples to bring them to God, she has been in exile because of her disobedience. She will be brought back from exile, and then all the nations will come to her. And that's the picture throughout here. Notice where it mentions in the last of verse 5, the wealth of the nations will come to you. What a change of events. Instead of war and destruction and exile, will be caravans and ships full of goods coming to God's people. Now, in verse 7 it mentions Kedar, the flocks of Kedar, and then Naboth. Now this really, the Greek and Roman term for these people is Nabateans. We see them in Genesis 25:13. These are Arab tribes that are going to bring wealth. In verse 8, it sounds a little funny when you first read it. It says, fly like a cloud, the doves to their lattices. Well, unless you look at verse 9, verse 8 is just uninterpretable. It's talking about the sails of ships on the horizon as they come to Palestine from the Mediterranean Sea. Now, these ships are called the ships of Tarshish. Now, archaeology has found some smelter cities in southern Spain by this name. And so it may be a literal geographical location of southern Spain. Some think it's proverbial for the ends of the earth, and either one fits quite well. Now, let's go to the next page. Notice the latter part of verse 10. For in my wrath I struck you, and in my favor I have compassion on you. Here in one sentence is the two extremes the Bible talks about in the nature of God. One is that God is love. His whole action toward man is grace-oriented, kindness-oriented, forgiveness-oriented. But friends, I want to tell you the book that tells us God is love is the book that tells us that God's love spurned produces wrath and rejection that lasts through eternity as God's love lasts through eternity. God's love is a serious thing. Now, listen to verse 11 where it says, and your gates will be open continually. Well, that sounds very much like Revelation 21:25. It is obvious that John on the Isle of Patmos, in his closing chapters of his apocalypse, is using many of the metaphors of this section of Isaiah to describe the spiritual realities that he saw in heaven. Now, what does it mean the gates will be continually open? Well, two things, I think. Number one, the security of the city is assured, and therefore the gates can remain open. Number two, perpetual access to God is available, and therefore the gates being open symbolize that. It's a beautiful metaphor. And verse 12 it says, for the nations and the kingdom that will not serve you will perish, and the nations will be utterly ruined. Now this goes back to the Abrahamic covenant of Genesis 12, especially verse 3 where it says, those who bless you I will bless, and those who curse you I will curse. And that's a play on this Abrahamic covenant here. We see the same thing down in verses 21 and 22. Now, this says, my sanctuary, and it's talking about all these different kind of trees. I was looking at the pulpit commentary which said that meant they were going to plant these trees around Jerusalem because it was so desolate because of war. But I really think the metaphor is not so much a program of planting trees around Jerusalem, but that these beautiful woods from Lebanon are going to be used to rebuild the temple and especially the holy place where these woods are located. Now, this verse 17 is connected here with this thought. In verse 17, we mentioned several different kinds of metals, one common metals and one precious metals. I really think this refers to the rebuilding of the holy place also. For in 1 Kings 14, 26 and 27, the precious metals of the temple had to be stripped away to pay Pharaoh Necho II of Egypt from not invading the city. And they're going to be replaced, and the beauty of the temple will be restored, is what I believe it's talking about. Now let's go back to verse 13 where it mentions, my sanctuary, and I shall make that the place of my feet glorious. Here we have a picture of the Ark of the Covenant, as you can see. And what we have here is basically between the wings of the cherubim was where Israel believed that God dwelt among his people. But a correction of that theology says that between the wings of the cherubim were the footstool, the Ark of the Covenant being the footstool, and God's throne being in heaven. And that's the idea here about the place of my feet glorious. Now, when it mentions in the latter part of verse 14 the word and Zion, if you'll look at chapter 62, verse 1, you'll see that the name Zion, Mount Zion, and Jerusalem are synonymous. They're in a Hebrew parallel relationship. Now, the temple was on Mount Moriah where Abraham offered Isaac. But the word Zion came to mean all of Jerusalem, and they're used interchangeably. Now, here's a series of names about God. In verse 14, he's called the Holy One of Israel. In verse 16, he's called the Lord, which is from the Hebrew verb to be. See Exodus 3:14. Then he's called Savior. Now, this is a pretty rare term. The word Savior and the word Deliverer are related in Old Testament. A word Deliverer in the Old Testament primarily meant physical deliverance, but the word has a personal background, the sense of Goel, the kinsman redeemer like Boaz was in the book of Ruth. And then the mighty one of Jacob, you might want to see 49:26 where the same phrase is used, which speaks of God as a warrior. And so these titles put together describe the character of God. Notice in verse 15 through 22, this passage is very, very similar to Revelation 21. I have a graphic I'd like to show you because here we're really talking about some theology that I hope you'll listen to me. What does verse 15 through 22 relate to? Well, if you're talking about literal national Israel being restored, then this is the position of dispensational premillennialism. But now, personally, I believe we're talking about the church as spiritual Israel. This passage is very similar. The metaphors are exact. Revelation 21, 1 through 27. This phrase is also used over in chapter 61, 6, to describe the people of God as priests unto God, as they're described in Exodus 19, 5 and 6. And the same metaphors are used for the church in 1 Peter 2, 9. Now finally, if you'll look with me, in verse 15 it says, "You have been forsaken and hated." This is a metaphor of a wife being rejected. This same metaphor of a wife is found in chapter 62, verses 4 and 5. Now, it is used of the church in Ephesians 5, 21 through 31. I really believe the church is spiritual Israel. I get that from Romans 2, 28 and 29, Galatians 3, 29, and later on in Galatians where the church is called the Israel of God. I believe the church is spiritual Israel. Now, so this would either refer to literal Jerusalem or the new Jerusalem of the book of the Apocalypse. Now, notice these, when it says, "I will make peace your administrators," the last part of verse 17, "and righteousness your overseers." Now, I personally believe this relates to the messianic government described in Isaiah 7 through 14. And you probably need to go back and look at that. Now, in the first part of verse 18 about no violence will be heard, this is really talking about the messianic age, the age of the Messiah, this new period of blessing. There will be no social injustice and no social violence because people's lives will have been changed. The new heart and the new mind of Jeremiah 31, 31 through 34 will have been implanted in the people, and they will live the characteristics of God in their daily lives. Now, if you look at verses 19 and 20, this is what's repeated so beautifully in the book of the Revelation. The God will be their light. The sun and the moon will not count. Now, in the latter part of verse 20, it says, "And the days of your mourning will be finished." Now, you ought to see Isaiah 35:10, 65:19, and Revelation 21:4. Now, in verse 21, "And all your people will be righteous." There'll be a changed character. The new age will not come in until the people repent and they take on the Christ-like attitude and lifestyle. You might want to see Ephesians 4:13 about that. The goal for the church is that everyone be mature in Christ. That's the goal of the Bible, that Christ-like lifestyle. Then it says, "They'll possess the land forever." That goes back to the promise made to Abraham, Genesis 17:8. Notice it says, "The branch of my planting." This idea of a branch is picked up on in chapter 61, verse 3, where it calls, they will be called the oaks of righteousness and the planting of the Lord. Now, this is very, very similar to Psalms 1. And I think there's an allusion here. But there is a further allusion to Isaiah 11, 1, about a shoot will spring from Jesse. And then Isaiah 61, 3 is where it's picked up on. So I think that's the background here. Notice the last part where it says, "I, the Lord, will hasten it in its time." You all see chapter 61, 11. God is in control of history. Nothing just happens outside the will of God, both for nations and for individuals. Now, chapter 61. Notice it says, "The Spirit of the Lord God," and this is in Hebrew, it's Adonai Yahweh, the Lord, Lord, but it doesn't make good sense in English. This is not the full-blown Trinitarian sense, although Jesus uses it like that when he quotes this of himself. But you may want to see chapter 11, verse 1 and 2, and chapter 42, 1, for a similar use of this phrase. Now, this is used or quoted by Jesus to describe himself in Mark 4, 16 through 21, Luke 4, 16 through 21, and Luke 7, 18 through 23. So this passage is messianic because Jesus applies it to himself. Now, "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me." Now, what does that mean? Well, it may mean about Jesus' baptism, where the dove symbolizing the Holy Spirit came down from heaven. I think the Holy Spirit was always on Jesus. At age 12, it's obviously he knew he had a unique relationship to the Father. I think the dove coming down was more for the crowd and John the Baptist than it was for Jesus himself. But you might want to see Matthew 3:16. Now, this idea about the Lord has anointed me. The term anointed is the term Messiah. Now, someone was anointed, was a prophet, priest, or king. John Calvin says, uses those threefold titles for Jesus, prophet, priest, king, because he fulfilled all those offices. Anointing means someone especially chosen and especially equipped by God. And the symbol of that was the anointing of the holy oil the priest did. Now, this idea about it being anointed, you can see in Psalms 23:5. Okay, now, let's look, if we could, where it mentions, bring good news to the afflicted, has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and freedom to the prisoners. What a message of hope and forgiveness to these outcast people this was. God had not forgotten them. God would forgive their sin, draw them back to himself. Even the most weak and humble and poor of them, God would restore. Now, in verse 2, notice it says, the favorable year of the Lord, the day of vengeance of our God. This favorable year is the year of Jubilee, Leviticus 25:10. Now, I want to say to you, just like last chapter, verse 10, it talked about my wrath and my love. The year of Jubilee and the day of vengeance are one day. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, I want to say to you, that when the eastern skies open and Jesus Christ comes again as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, for those of us who know him, there'll be no greater day of rejoicing and hallelujahs and singing praise. But, oh, my God, what a day it's going to be for those who don't know him. It'll be a day of praise and a day of wailing, a day of joy and a day of unspeakable sadness, all at the same time. Now, notice it mentions in verse 3, a garland, ashes, oil of gladness, mantle of praise. These are things to describe, if you would, good things that are placed on the head, are signs of mourning that are placed on the head. And there are several of them. Now in verse 4 it says, they rebuild the ancient ruins. These ancient ruins apparently were the walls of Jerusalem and the temple itself. It's used quite often in Isaiah 49:8, 58:2, 60, verse 10. Now when it mentions, the rest of verse 7, verse 4, it speaks of the return from the exile. Notice it says, the strangers will stand and pasture your flocks, foreigners will be your farmers and your vine dressers. As the nations came to bring prizes to the new Jerusalem, they'll come to serve the people of God. And that's the idea here. Notice in verse 6 where it says, but you'll be called the priests of the Lord, and you'll be spoken of as ministers of our God. The purpose of Israel in the Old Testament was to bring all the world to God. But they become arrogant and turned inward. Church, be careful that doesn't happen to us. For God can raise up a new people just as he raised up the church. Remember that. Now, in verse 7, it says, the double portion twice. Now, this originally was the inheritance of the first son, the double portion. It may be related to the idea of double their sins in chapter 40, verse 2, or this firstborn idea is from Deuteronomy 21:17. Notice where it mentions, for I, the Lord, love justice. We must never forget that God, Yahweh, is an ethical, moral God. He doesn't want ritual as much as he wants ethical obedience and love. Never get fouled up, friends, that liturgy or religious symbol or religious acts please God. Those acts, those liturgy and those symbols are significant when they're in the framework of a life of love for others based on God's love for us. Now, notice it says, I hate robbery in the burnt offerings. Well, now, we could have with iniquity. That's what the Septuagint has, and that reading is possible in the Masoretic text. I hate robbery with iniquity. And it seems like we're not so much in a cultic context here as an ethical context, so I think with iniquity is better. Now, then it says, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them. We must remember that the word olam in Hebrew must be dated or must be interpreted in light of the context. God's first covenant with them was supposed to be forever, and yet because of their sin, it was cut off. The new covenant of Jeremiah 31, 31 through 34 is eternal as long as we keep our stipulations, our part. We must remember that. Now, in verse 9 again, we have the idea of Israel as a message to other nations. The same thing is in the latter part of verse 11. Israel is meant to be a message. I still believe God has a place for national Israel. I still believe the miracle of the nation of Israel in our day and her success in war is a word to the people of the earth of the faithfulness of God. Not because of the Jewish faithfulness, but God is faithful to his word, and he proves that by working with the people who at this point have not repented and not turned back to him. Modern Israel is not a spiritual state. It is a secular Zionist state, and until they turn to the Messiah, they will not have the full blessings of God. Now, notice it said, the Lord will, and latter part, middle part of verse 11, so the Lord will cause righteousness and praise to string before all the nations. I want to tell you this, God is in control of history. Whatever happened, he causes. Now we'll see 40, verse 8, 55, verses 10 and 11. Now chapter 62. For Zion's sake, I will not be silent. For Jerusalem's sake, I will not keep quiet. Now, the person speaking in chapter 62 is obviously the same person speaking in chapter 61. Some think it is the anointed prophet speaking on behalf of God. Obviously, it is going to be fulfilled later in the ministry and life of the Messiah, but it has to be historically fulfilled to some extent in Isaiah's day. And there's the paradox of all Old Testament prophecy. Any crisis in history was used as a way of foreshadowing what God was going to do in the end time. Notice it says, righteousness goes forth like brightness, and salvation like the torch of burning. There are those metaphors of light again, like back in chapter 60, verses 1. Now, this is reflected in Matthew 5, 13 through 16. Light is a symbol of God's message going out, as well as God himself. The word here, righteousness, and the word salvation are in a parallel relationship in Hebrew. Righteousness means a measuring reed. It's the standard of God himself. It's a legal term, and it means straightness. All the words for sin mean crookedness. We are righteous because of God's love for us. It's an imputed righteousness, as we learn from the New Testament, especially Romans 3:21 through 5:11. Now, salvation, that's physical deliverance in the Old Testament, but it came to mean spiritual deliverance as well as physical. Now, notice where the nations will see your righteousness. There again, Israel is meant to be a light to the nations. Now, in the latter part of verse 3, it says, the crown of beauty in the hand of the Lord, the royal diadem, they're in parallel relationship again. The ideal of the divinic king is used to describe the Messiah. Now, in verse 4, there are several names. Notice this, forsaken, desolate, my delight is in her, married. The word married is the word Beulah. You ever heard of the term Beulah land? Well, it's the Hebrew word married. And here again is that metaphor of Israel as a forsaken wife brought back. And that metaphor is carried on down in verse 5. You can see it again in 60:15. Okay? Let's go to verse 6. On your walls, O Jerusalem, I have appointed watchmen. Now, who are these watchmen? Well, from Ezekiel 31, I believe these watchmen, today they would be the preachers, the proclaimers of the message of God. In that day, they would have been the prophets that spoke for God. They would not be silent. They continued to speak. And notice what they said. Night, all day, and all night, they have never kept silent. Now, this may be a reference. The rabbis say these watchmen were not preachers, but angels. And they go back to Zechariah 1, 12 through 17 as a proof text. You who remind the Lord, take no rest for yourself. What he's saying, Paul would say, preach in season and out of season is what he's talking about. And give him, capital H, God, no rest until he, God, establishes and makes Jerusalem a praise in the earth. What they're saying is, God's saying, you keep on preaching my promises. You keep on sharing what I promised to do, and I'm going to do it. The more you proclaim it, the more I'm going to get excited about fulfilling it. I think we ought to preach the blessings and promises of God, and God will fulfill them because they're spoken in his name and he stands by his promises. Now, notice where it says, the Lord has sworn by his right hand and by his strong arm. This is an anthropomorphic phrase to describe the fact that God is not only transcendent or different or other, but he is imminent and active and available in our daily lives as individuals and in our national life. God is on the throne and he is in control of history. Now, when it says, I will never again give grain for food to your enemies, this is a scribe of siege, an invasion. Deuteronomy 28, 30 through 33 said, if you leave my blessings, if you leave my law, you're going to be cursed. And part of the curse was the invasion, and that's going to be removed. Now, in verse 9 it says, and those who gather in it will drink in the courts of my sanctuary. This is, of course, referring to wine. It's the fellowship meal, God meeting with his people in small groups for fellowship. Deuteronomy 12 of 18. I think it's the Old Testament background to the Lord's Supper. Now, in verse 10, two imperatives. Go through, imperative, go through the gates. These gates are standing open wide, but man must go in them. The Jews had to return from the exile. I'm an evangelical Christian. I believe man must respond to the promises of God, and that's what I think it's talking about here. Now, when it says, build up the highway, clear the way, there's that same metaphor that John the Baptist used for himself. You might want to see Isaiah 35, 8 through 10, the highway of holiness, or chapter 40, verse 3 and 4, used in the book of Malachi again to describe the one who prepared the way for the Messiah. Now, notice it says, behold, the Lord has proclaimed to the ends of the earth. God's spoken to all people through what he's done to the nation of Israel, and he still does that. Now, look at these last few titles. And they will call them. Remember the titles for God earlier? They're going to be reflected now in what His people are called. They're going to be called the holy people, not just the Holy One of Israel, but now holy people. Exodus 19, 4 and 5. The redeemed of the Lord, not just the Goel, the Redeemer, but now His people are going to be the redeemed, and they're going to be redeemers themselves. Notice it says, and you who will be called sought out. Now that's the idea of a marriage term again, a wife forsaken, but now brought back. A city not forsaken. So here's that metaphor of a put away wife. You see, the breaking of the covenant and God's sin to exile was analogous to a divorce. The whole book of Hosea is built in the same metaphor. And now He's pulling them back to Himself, establishing a new covenant, a new marriage vow, if you please. The idea of a marriage vow is very similar to the biblical idea of the faith relationship between God and His people, both in the corporate sense of Israel and in the individual sense of the New Testament. These three chapters, I think, are not so much going to be fulfilled literally in the future, but they're describing the relationship between Jesus and His people, the church, His bride, in the day in which we live now. Now, I'm not saying that God does not have a place for national physical Israel in the eschaton. I believe He does. You can't read Romans 9 through 11 without knowing that God has a place for the Jews. But I also believe that the church has inherited all the promises for the nation that was rejected, because they rejected not only their call to be a kingdom of priests, but they rejected the Messiah Himself when He came. And that blindness on the part of the Jews is still in place today while God is working among the Gentile people. So there's a lot of questions here as it deals with the millennial position. I don't think we can solve all that, but simply to say, I'm so glad that God's in the business of making promises, and that all I have to do is count on His promises and I'll never be disappointed. I've really enjoyed being with you, and I'll see you again, same time, same place, next week. God bless you.